No need to turn on the camera. You may please turn off the camera. Hello?
Yes, please.
No need to turn on the camera. Please turn off the camera. Please turn off. Okay, so MEG1, Geoffrey Chaucer's Canterbury Tales. Is it clear?
Okay.
Then MEG2, Edmund Spenser's Epithalamion and Prothalamion. Okay. Edmund Spenser's Epithalamion and Prothalamion. Then Block 3. Metaphysical poets. Block 4. John Milton's poetry. Okay, John Milton's poetry. Lycidas, Nativity, Ode, and other sonnets. John Milton's poetry. I hope you have got that course book. Do you have that course book?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Then fifth module, John Dryden and Alexander Pope's poetry, that is Macfleckno and Epistle. John Dryden and Alexander Pope. And Block 6 is about Wordsworth and Coleridge, early romantics. Poetry of early romantic poets. Wordsworth and Coleridge. Block 7, later romantic poets such as Shelley, Keats. Then Block 8 is about later romantic poets. Now block six, early romantic poets. Block 7, later romantic poets such as Shelley and Keats, and Block 8. Victorian poets such as Robert Browning, then Rossetti, DJ Rossetti, Christina Rossetti, then William Blake. Block 9, modern poets. T.S. Eliot's poem, Wasteland, and William Butler Yeats' poem. Okay, his poems. Now, Block 10, postmodern poetry, Dylan Thomas, Philip Larkin, and Sylvia Plath's poems. Okay. So you have 10 blocks. Let me tell you something. We'll be getting only 10 sessions. That means 20 hours. Okay. So we need to cover somewhat 100 plus poems in these 20 hours time. Okay. More than 100. And one more thing. MEG1 is the toughest paper of all. This one, poetry paper, is very tough. So you have to complete the poem. If I'm holding class today, then that day itself you have to complete the topic. Otherwise, if you're opening the book after 2 months or 3 months, you won't remember anything. Okay. Block 10, postmodern poets, Dylan Thomas, Sylvia Plath, and Philip Larkin. So we'll be covering each block in each class. Okay. So let me tell you, don't expect that I'll be able to cover line by line. I'll be able to explain line by line. It's not possible. It is impossible for any teacher to go line by line, that too in a very short period, 20 hours. So you will have assignment. And let me tell you one more thing. You can expect annotations and essay questions for the exam, annotation as well as essay questions. All right. So one more thing. When you prepare for exam, please download previous year's question paper. Okay. Now, anything else? Can you see the, oh, one second, let me share the screen. So can you see the screen? Hello?
Yes, madam.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Oh, okay, one second. If you want, you can take screenshots. All right. Those who want, please take the screenshots. Now, so tell me, what do you know about Geoffrey Chaucer? Do you have any idea about Geoffrey Chaucer and his poems?
Yes, madam. I think Geoffrey.
What do you know about him? Being a literature student, I mean, most of you might have done your graduation in English literature. So you might be having some idea about Geoffrey Chaucer.
Yeah, Geoffrey Chaucer is the father of English literature, and also.
Yeah, why he has been called as the father of English language, tell me. Can you give me the answer for that? Why he has been called as the father of English language? Yeah, let's see. So Geoffrey Chaucer, who was born in 1343 and died in 1400, was widely considered as the father of English language. And there are several reasons for considering him as the father of English language. You know, was the very first reason? He's the one who found the English dialect. Okay, and left it as a language. He's the one who found the English. During his time, there were five major dialects in England. But he is the one who found the East Midland dialect and left it as a language. Now, so he standardized English language. So when you write an essay about Geoffrey Chaucer, include these points. Okay, point is very important. You needn't have to write what the poet has born about his personal life, nothing like that. But whatever thing you include in the essay, that should be valid. Okay. So he's considered as the greatest poet. Yeah, greatest poet of the Middle Age. 1100 to 1500. Middle English period. I hope you know that. You have studied history of English language, right? So a period from 1100 to 1500 AD is considered to be English, I mean Middle English period. He is regarded as a father of English poetry because he standardized English. Until till 13th century, there were so many dialects in England. Actually, the dialect spoken by one person. I mean, I told you there are many dialects in England. So, language spoken in one section. Will not be it's pretty difficult to understand by other person from some other section. Got it? So in Kerala we have many districts, right? So the ones the language that is Malayalam that is used in Kasaragod, it will not be able to I mean a person from Trivandrum, he will not be able to understand the language of Kasaragod. That was the condition of England then. Okay, even though language is English, it had many dialects. So he is the one who standardized English. He has chosen East Midland dialect and he used that in writing until Chaucer, and I mean until Chaucer, other writers, they have used French and Latin, but he is the one, he used English. Now Edward Albert, critic, the famous critic, called him the earliest of the great moderns and the morning star of Renaissance. See, this person has won several appellations. He has won several praises. He has been called the earliest of the great moderns and the morning star of Renaissance. And he is the first one to teach the art of versification. Versification means what? Poetry writing. He's the first one to set rules for poetry writing. So these are the several reasons behind why he has been called as the father of English language. So can you, I just want to confirm, so are you able to see this slide?
Yes, miss.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So I'm changing the slide. Okay. Rhyme Royal, also known as Chaucerian stanza, was introduced to English poetry, and he was the person who introduced Rhyme Royal. Rhyme Royal to English poetry. Okay. So let's see what is Rhyme Royal. Rhyme Royal stanza consists of 7 lines, usually in iambic pentameter. What do you mean by iambic pentameter, class? What is iambic pentameter? That is a meter. In Malayalam, for non-literature student, students, see, in Malayalam we have vrittam and all, isn't it? Lagu guru. Similarly, in English we have stress unstressed patterns. Scansion. It is known as scansion. Okay, a meter. Unstressed followed by a stress is said to be iamb. Is it clear? Unstressed followed by a stress is said to be an iamb. So, iambic pentameter. In iambic pentameter, there will be 5 feet. 5 feet. 5 iambs. 5 iambs will be there. Rhyme Royal stanza consists of 7 lines, usually in iambic pentameter, and the rhyming scheme is ABABBCZ. Okay. Anyway, this person has adapted Rhyme Royal scheme from French ballads and Italian stanza form. As you know that English is the youngest language, somewhat 10,000 words have been borrowed from French. Similarly, 15,000 or more have been borrowed from Italian language. So these are the, I'm getting you the different reasons why this person has been called the father of English language. Actually, he's the one who refined the language. Okay, old English language is pretty difficult to understand, but he's the one who has introduced the so-called rules in poetry. Poetry writing. He also introduced 8-line decasyllabic stanza and heroic couplet. Heroic couplet is nothing but rhymed iambic pentameter. Okay, it is rhymed iambic pentameter lines. If it is if the lines are not rhyming, it is said to be blank verse. Okay, I repeat, heroic couplet is nothing but rhymed iambic pentameter. So he's the person. So now tell me why he has been called the father of English poetry. Now, come on, get me the answers. Yeah.
The English language becomes standardized.
Yeah.
East Midland dialect.
Ma'am, he standardized the English language.
Yes. Yes, he standardized the English language apart. He's the first one to teach art of versification. Then he is the one who found the English dialect. Okay. He's the one who found the English dialect and left it as a language. And he introduced Rhyme Royal scheme to English poetry from French. Now, let's see his French and Latin influences. See, Geoffrey Chaucer was a voracious reader. And this person, he was influenced by Latin and French literature, especially Dante Alighieri, Francisco Petrarch, Giovanni Boccaccio. See, from Boccaccio, he borrowed the materials for Troilus and Cressida and Canterbury Tales. The poem that we are going to discuss right now, that is Canterbury Tales. He has drawn the materials for Canterbury Tales from Boccaccio's Decameron. Oh, okay, Decameron. We will discuss that later. Boccaccio's poetry's name is Decameron. So, who are the three Latin poets who have influenced, Chaucer, Dante Alighieri, Francisco Petrarch, Giovanni, Boccaccio. He modeled them. Not only, Geoffrey Chaucer, who was influenced by, deeply influenced by three poets. Almost all Middle English poets were influenced by these Italian writers. Okay. So don't forget the fact that those who are preparing for competitive exams, NET or something like that, please note this. He borrowed materials for Canterbury's Tales from Boccaccio, Boccaccio's Decameron. Decameron, D-E-C-A-M-E-R-O-N, Decameron. Okay, I forgot to include that in the slide. Maybe in the next slides, we will discuss about Decameron. Have you got the spelling? D for donkey, okay, D, Decameron, D-E-C-A-M-E-R-O-N, Decameron, Boccaccio's Decameron, principal book, from where he borrowed the materials for Canterbury Tales. Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, madam.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, yeah, it's over here. Boccaccio's Decameron having different characters tell stories seem to have an obvious inspiration for Canterbury's Tales. Let me tell you something. We do have similar tales like Canterbury Tales and Decameron. I think you are familiar with Panchatantra tales, Arabian 1001 Arabian Nights, tale within a tale, many tales, isn't it? So Canterbury Tale is also like that. Story about storytelling. You can link with that. You are literature students. So whenever you write, your writing should be comparative. Okay, you should compare with other literature. You should compare with other poems. So this poem is about storytelling. From Petrarch, he derived the story that became Clerk's Tale in Canterbury's Tales. Let me tell you, there are many tales in Canterbury Tales. Okay. But there are altogether 17,000 lines in Canterbury Tales, 17,000 lines. But you needn't have to study 17,000 lines. You have only somewhat 800 lines to study. That is prologue. Anyway, it is Chaucer who translated Dante's Divine Comedy and other major works to English. Now, we are discussing why this person is very important in English language. Because he's the one who has translated Dante's famous work, Divine Comedy, into English. Now, before discussing about Canterbury Tales, we need to have an idea about the English during Middle English period. Okay, so let's discuss about evolution of English. Old English period. Please note this. Old English period is from, one second. Old English period is from 597 AD to 1100 AD. And see, Old English language is entirely different from the one that we use today. I hope you are familiar with that. Beowulf is the most famous literary work of the period, and author is anonymous. Okay. All those literature written during, which have been written during Old English period, exhibited the quality of Germanic English. I hope you know that English is a language that has derived from Germanic language that you will study in history of English. Now, next period, Middle English period, 1100 AD to 1500 AD, Chaucer's period. So mark this, Chaucer belonged to Middle English period, and the period starts from 1100 AD to 1500 AD. Geoffrey Chaucer is the most important writer of this period, and the most important work of the period is none other than Canterbury Tales. Okay, so and the literature of this period exhibited the influence of French and Italian literature. Please don't shuffle with Old English period. Old English literature exhibited the quality of Germanic literature, whereas Middle English literature exhibited the qualities of French and Italian literature. Now, modern English period. It starts from 1500 AD to the present. Okay. And see, 15 modern English period, 1500 AD to the present. I mean, famous authors. Shakespeare, Milton, Swift, Wordsworth, Charles Dickens, T.S. Eliot. I mean, present authors. Now, Chaucer's language, we have already seen that this person belonged to the Middle English period. Now, other than English, French, Latin were the other two languages used by people in England. French, the language of aristocracy. I mean, all those courtiers and king, they use French. Then clergy and scholars in church, they use Latin. And English was the language of commoners. Hello, can you see the slide? If you're not able to see, if you're not able, if you're not able to see the slide, you please inform me. I will share it again. Okay. Because whatever details I'm conveying through this slide are very important. Okay. Now, yeah. I hope you are familiar with the difference in pronunciation of Middle English. Than that of the modern English. I mean, the actually there is a great difference in pronunciation from the one that we use today. Okay, in Middle English, a sound is brought as that, the modern English father. Like, see, when we pronounce when, nowadays when is pronounced as when, isn't it? When. In those time, it was pronounced as one. Okay. Can you see the words when? W-H-A-N, when? Class, can you see this?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes,
so in modern,
yes,
in modern English, this is W-H-E-N, when. In modern English, it is W-H-E-N, when. But in Middle English, this was pronounced as one. In modern English, this is April. Okay, this is April. Month April. Middle English April. This is March. Bath, hath. This is small. S-M-A-L-L, small in modern English, but in Middle English, smaller. You got it? Smaller. This is Ram. So, I mean, A sound it was broad. It was They pronounce A sound little bit in a broad way. Short E has the same pronunciation in modern English. Can you see this one? Smaller, sooty, melody. Oh, 1 second. These words, smaller, sooty, melody, young, seek. This is the way how they pronounce these words. So wherever there are vowels, they stressed it. If the vowel, even if vowel, letter comes at the end of a word, they pronounce this, they stressed it. In modern English, we will pronounce small, suit, melody, young, seek, isn't it? But in Middle English, these words are pronounced in this way, smaller, sooty, melody, young, seek. I hope you have got an awareness about the pronunciation. Pronunciation was entirely different from the modern English. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, next one. Long E has long A sound. Sweat, breath, heat, seek. E is pronounced as A. Sweaty, breathy, breathy, heat, seek. Then this one. G, droggy, night. Then this one. R sound is trilled. We know that nowadays we won't actually, we Indians have a tendency to roll our tongue. But English people, they don't roll their tongue, isn't it? April, tender, courageous. Modern English, April, tender, courageous. But the way they pronounce those words, April, trilling, they are trilling the tongue. They will roll their tongue. Have you understood? They stress R. Just like Malayalam sound. Okay. Just like Malayalis, they used to roll their tongue.
next, what is guttural?
I mean, see, it is a sound that comes from, deep throat. Deep throat, guttural sounds. Okay. Now, England during the period of Chaucer. So, before getting into Canterbury Tales, you need to know the condition of England. Political, social condition of England. And 13th century, broadly 14th century, England, that was a very corrupted period. Feudalism was coming to an end. Anyway, that period witnessed tremendous social, political, and economical changes in England. Now, still, you can see some elements of feudalism, but the century witnessed the growth of many cities like London. Okay. Then, commerce and other industry gave rise to the merchant class. Okay. Until then, there were only three classes in England. Till Chaucer's period, there were only three classes in England. Aristocratic class, clergy class, and commoners. Okay. I repeat, till Chaucer's period, before his period, there were only three classes, aristocratic, clergy class, and third one, commoners. But from Chaucer's period onwards, people began to witness many changes in England. Feudalism, actually it has reached its last stage because industry, commerce, etc. have been progressed, and that has resulted to the rise, gave rise to the merchant class people. Let me tell you something. At that time in England, there were only 250,000 people. It was estimated that there were only some less than 3 lakhs people in England. Less than 3 lakhs. Okay. And Black Death, plague, it has swept England thrice. I think you are familiar with the Black Death, bubonic plague and all. That has swept England thrice. And England has witnessed holy wars. Those who are familiar with history, I think you are familiar with the 100 years of war between France and England, isn't it? It's the longest war in history.
Yes, madam.
Yeah, 100 years. Yeah, 100 years of war. 100 years of war between
French and
England. Yeah. So England has witnessed many political and social changes like that. Then the growth of the church. Let me tell you, church and clergy people were very much corrupted during those time. Okay. Then rise of, many universities like Oxford and Cambridge. So these are the major changes of Chaucer's England. Okay. So when you write an essay, don't simply write the story. If you're asked to write the very social political background of the England, you have to include all these points in your essay. It doesn't matter whether you have written 10 or 20 pages. What they're looking for is for points. Okay. What they're looking for in the essay is points. So you must include all these points. Now, the next thing. Now let's discuss about Canterbury Tales. So I told you, Canterbury Tales, it's a collection of 24 stories. 24 stories. Our present Canterbury Tales is a collection of 24 stories. It's written about 70,000 lines. Written in Middle English by Geoffrey Chaucer. Just like Panchatantra Tales, Arabian Night, 1001 Arabian Nights, this is a story about storytelling. Metafiction type. Story within a story. Okay. Now, the very uniqueness of this Canterbury Tales lies in its characterization. Okay. Chaucer, I told you there are 24 tales told by different characters. There are 29 characters from different strata of English society. He has drawn so many. See, you know why this Canterbury Tales have stood the test of time? It is written in 14th century, but still we are reading, still it is prescribed in the syllabus. Why? What's the reason?
Because it's the first book written in proper English, standard English.
And that is one reason. That is one reason. And the second reason is, this man was able to portray, I mean, people from all strata of English lives. I mean, this can entertain all readers from all centuries, from 13th to 21st century. The work was able to entertain all readers from all classes. Even if you read this, it will bring a smile on your face. This work has truly stood the test of time. All characters in Prologue to Canterbury Tales are drawn from different class of 14th century English society. Okay, now I told you, let us summarize the work in few lines. Let's see. Poem, there's a long poem. It speaks about a pilgrimage. Anyway, there are 29 pilgrims, plus Chaucer and his host, there will be 31 members. Please note the number. There are 29 pilgrims. And Chaucer is the narrator. Chaucer is a character as well as he's a narrator. Remember, please mark it. Geoffrey Chaucer is a narrator as well as a character. So 29 pilgrims plus Chaucer plus the host of the Tabard Inn. That makes 31 members. Okay, let me tell you the story in a nutshell. So on a spring day, 29 pilgrims traveling from Tabard Inn in Southwark to the shrine of Thomas Becket in Canterbury Tales, that which is 55 miles away from England. Now, what do you know about Thomas Becket? Have you heard about Thomas Becket, St. Thomas Becket? About him, you will study in detail in MEG2, that is in British drama. You have a... Yeah, that's a famous cathedral in England, yes. Apart from that, what do you know about Thomas Becket? Have you heard about him? Okay. Anyway, you will in MEG2, you will study more about him. St. Thomas Becket, he was a libertine at first. He was a close friend of Henry II. Later, Henry II and Thomas Becket got into dispute. And Henry II has given order to kill Thomas Becket. Henry II's knights, they have killed Thomas Becket in the Cathedral of Canterbury. Okay, thereafter... After so many years, he has been canonized. He has become a saint. And Canterbury, I mean, Shrine of Thomas Becket is believed to have so many healing qualities. People are going to, those 29 pilgrims are going to Canterbury, Shrine of Thomas Becket, just because they believe that the particular sender has got some great healing qualities. He's quick in giving blessing to those people who come to him. Okay, so all those people who are going to Canterbury, they will be having some kind of diseases. Okay, they'll be having some kind of diseases. That is why they are going to get blessings from St. Thomas Becket. I told you, he's a martyr. He was killed by the followers of Henry II. Actually, Henry II and Thomas Becket were great friends once. Later, they got, after becoming the Archbishop, St. Thomas Becket was the Archbishop of England. Okay, he was the Archbishop of England. After becoming Archbishop of England, his character changed. He became a very good human and he has excommunicated. He has excommunicated several followers of Henry II for their immoral ways. After that, two became enemies. That is the reason why he was killed in the cathedral. And thus he became a martyr. And after several years, this person was canonized. Now he is the saint of Canterbury. So who is the saint of Canterbury? Saint Thomas Becket.
Thomas Becket.
So 29 pilgrims are going to seek his blessing. Yeah. Now, I told you this is a story about storytelling. Then who suggested about the storytelling? Apart from 29 pilgrims and Chaucer, we have a host. host in this story. His name is Halle Bailey. Okay, Halle Bailey. He's the one who suggested about this story telling, because 55 miles on the top of the horse was a tedious journey, isn't it? Nowadays, we have different transportation. It's not a big deal to cover 55 miles. But in 14th century, covering 55 miles, that was a tedious journey. Of course, so in order to make that journey enjoyable and pleasurable, this person, host of that Tabard Inn, he suggested that they have to tell story. So actually, the some story is like this. See, Geoffrey Chaucer, he's a narrator as well as a character in Canterbury Tales. He was waiting for the next day, so as to resume his journey. Okay, at that time only 29 pilgrims reached that inn. I hope you know what an inn is. Tabard Inn. The name of the inn is Tabard Inn. Okay, please remember that. Chaucer was allowed to their company. When Chaucer was allowed to their company, what's the number now? 30, isn't it? 30. Yeah. So the next day, when they are about to resume their journey to Canterbury Tales, Canterbury. Host of the Tabard Inn. He suggested that, see, this journey is of course going to be very tedious. So let me make a suggestion in order to make it more enjoyable. Each one, I mean, how many members are there? 29 members, isn't it? So each one of them should tell two tales on their way to Canterbury and two tales on their way back home. Okay. So each person has to tell how many tales? Four tales, isn't it? Four tales. So altogether, how many? Imagine 30 pilgrims are there. 30 into 4, how many tales will be there if each person tells four tales on their way to Canterbury and way back to home? 120 tales will be there, isn't it? So that was the condition put forward by host. And the best story teller would get a sumptuous dinner. What is the prize? What is the prize for the storyteller? I mean, one who wins the game, he would get a sumptuous dinner served by the host. So you should remember all these points. If Chaucer had completed his original plans, there would have been 120 tales. Okay. See, if all these, 29 pilgrims plus Chaucer, if they had told four tales, then there would have been 120 tales in total. But how many tales are there in Canterbury Tales? Tell me. Originally, how many tales are there in Canterbury?
24.
Only 24 tales. His original plan was to write 120 tales, but ended up in writing 24 tales. Okay. Now, so I have already discussed this point that the place is believed to have many great healing qualities. That is why people are heading to Canterbury. And only a few people are going to Canterbury for religious reason. Most of the people are going for their personal reasons. Okay, please mark that. So, I told you Canterbury Tale is a long poem. So before the Canterbury tales start, Chaucer gives a description about each of his characters in the prologue. I repeat, Canterbury Tale is a long poem of 24 tales, including prologue plus 24 tales. Have you got the structure of the poem? 20 prologue plus 24 tales. But you don't have to study 24 tales. You have only one tale to study. Nun's Priest Tale. You have only one tale. That is Nun's Priest Tale. But you have to study the prologue. In prologue, he gives the description of each of his characters. There are 29 pilgrims, right? From different strata of society. English society. So in prologue, he's describing all these characters in detail. Have you understood what we are going to study?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Excuse me, ma'am. Yeah. I had a small doubt. Yeah. Was his original work published, or is there reason to believe like we would have lost the rest of the tales and only 24 are available?
No, no, no. He has written only 24 stories. 24.
So it was published. I mean, it was printed in some form?
Only 24. He hasn't completed 120 tales. He originally had a plan to write 120 tales, but when published, there were only 24 tales.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so these are the characters. Please take the screenshot of the character list. So class, I told you, you have to study Prologue to Canterbury, not the entire poem, only Prologue to Canterbury. So there are some words, 700, 800 lines in this prologue. So not the line number. Narrator 20, about night, you can start from 43. Character description of squire start from 81. Yeoman start from 103. Prioress start from prioress plus 3. See, this prioress is accompanied by 3 priests. Have you seen plus 3?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, the prioress is accompanied by 3 priests. That is why plus 3. Anyway, character description of prioress starts from line 22, about monk from 169, friar 212, merchant 280, Oxford cleric 295, sergeant at law 319, Franklin 341, guildsman, haberdasher. Guildsman means working class people. What else? We can say that middle class people. Okay, haberdasher, dyer. Carpenter, weaver, carpet maker, 371, cook, 390, skipper or shipman, please write there, shipman, 398. If you're reading the poem, you may come across the word shipman, skipper or shipman, okay. Doctor of physic, 421. Let me tell you how you read this wife of Bath. In modern English, we read wife of Bath, isn't it? But in middle English, weefy of Bath. Weef. Have you understood the pronunciation? Weefy.
Yes.
Wherever there is vowels, vowel sounds, we will stress it. And it has got some. I told you, long E. E is pronounced as E. I is pronounced as E, and E is pronounced as long E. Now, parson, 488, plowman, 539, miller, line number 561, manciple, 585, reeve, 605, summoner, 641, partner, 689. And one more thing I wanted to tell you is that, see, it is important. I know it is pretty difficult to study all these characters at a stretch. So, for exam point of view, let me tell you the list of important characters. Please mark. Please, if you have a book and a pen, you may please note down. Knight is very important. Have you got it? Knight. Class?
Yes, ma'am.
Sometimes you will get annotation about knight. So if you're getting an annotation about knight, you have to write annotation in 3 paragraphs. Okay, you have to write annotation in 3 paragraphs. First paragraph, you may give a brief introduction about author and about Canterbury Tales. Don't write the biography of the author. Okay, please don't write the biography of the author. Simply just mention that he is the father of English language, the most popular work of the Middle English, and why he has been considered as the father of English poetry. Then you can mention about Canterbury Tales, importance of Canterbury Tales. Then you can summarize Canterbury Tales in a line or two in the introductory paragraph. Have you got it? Have you got the structure of the introductory paragraph?
Yes.
Now, in second stanza, just translate the annotation. If you're getting a paragraph about night, you may please translate it. Because translation is given at the back of the textbook. If you have the IGNO textbook, at the back of your text, you will have modern English translation. The one that is prescribed for study is middle English poem. Hmm? But it will be pretty difficult for you to study middle English poems. So when you read the middle English Canterbury Tales, please compare it with the modern English translation. Okay, modern English translation. So that won't be a big deal for you. So you can compare and study. And let me tell you one thing. If you're familiar with the summary and the characters of Canterbury Tales, then it's not going to be a big problem when you get a character for exam. Because when you see the character, when you see the place name, or when you see something related to the particular character, you can easily understand, oh, this is about the particular character, knight, or this is about yeoman or friar. So the first and foremost thing which I would like to tell you is, have a clear-cut idea about the summary, character, and their characteristics. Got it? It's a long poem. And let me tell you, it is impossible for you to go line by line. But if you are able to go line by line, it will be better. Or else, have a... just read the summary, then just read the poem one time. You cannot mug up this poem just like you have done in your previous, degree classes. Degree classes, you might have learned a poem that of 300 lines, 400 lines that you can mug up. But this poem is very impossible just because it is written in Middle English. Now, please note down the character list, knight. Then squire, yeoman, prioress, monk, friar. This much is important. First, have you seen the section till friar? Knight, squire, yeoman, prioress, monk, friar. This much is important. Now, the next important character is Oxford cleric. You may please note down Oxford cleric. Have you seen that Oxford cleric? That line is very important. Now, you may come to weave of Bath. Have you seen this weave of Bath? Weave of Bath, that is very important. Then summoner and partner, very important. And let me tell you, there are only three virtuous characters, only three good characters in Canterbury Tales. I told you this Canterbury Tale is a social commentary, a social satire. Actually, yes, Geoffrey Chaucer has given a picture of 14th century England. That was very corrupted then. England was very corrupted then. So the three good characters are Parson and Plowman and Oxford Cleric. So tell me who are the three virtuous characters in Canterbury Tales? There are only three virtuous characters.
Parson, Plowman,
and Oxford Cleric. Please note the line numbers. Rest of the characters are very malicious, shrewd, and cunning. Okay. Rest of the characters are very malicious, rude, corrupted. Note the line numbers. Shall I change the slide?
Ma'am, just a moment. Do we need to include host and narrator along with knight, squire, and yeoman, prioress, and all?
Yes, you have to.
Ma'am, and one more thing I wanted to ask you.
Yeah,
Because I was going through this book, I'm from a non-English background. Like I have done MPhil in political science and all, but not related to literature. So
okay.
There are so many, Spenserian stanza, octave rhyme. So it is difficult for me to understand all those things. And they are saying this word needs to be stressed. And they have given a particular kind of a mark and all. How to, do we have to stress that?
Actually, nowadays it's not asked for the exam. Okay. You needn't have to study right now. Anyway, it will be better if you have an idea about these kind of meters, rhyme and all.
Yeah.
Anyway, that we will discuss in the coming class. Okay. Don't worry about that.
Sure, ma'am. Thank you.
Anyway, let me tell you, for your knowledge, let me tell you, I'm also from a non-literature background. I had my graduation in physics. After that, only I done my post-graduation in literature. Not a big deal.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, so let's discuss about the class structure during Chaucer's time. Class structure during Chaucer's time. ruling class. So these 29, I told you these 29 characters belong to different strata of English society. So knight and squire, they belong to ruling class. Then clergy class, monk, friar, prioress, parson, summoner, and partner. Then middle class, Franklin Reeve, doctor of psych, Oxford student, wife of bus, surgeon of law. They belong to the middle class. Now, trade, working class, trade class, Gelsman, cook, miller, horse, manciple, and merchant. They belong to the trade class. Peasant, shipman. Actually, the skipper is shipman. Plowman and yeoman belong to peasant class. Okay, peasant. Now, let's discuss those characters in detail. So the first character that Chaucer describes in his Canterbury is knight. Okay. Knight. So as we have seen, he's belonged to the ruling class. He is very godly dressed. Then he's very strong. And he has fought in many battles. Then, just like every knight, he's very wise, modest, distinguished, chivalrous, truthful, honorable, and courteous. Let me tell you something. Whatever thing that Chaucer has told about his character, that is ironic. That is an irony. Actually, all his characters are exactly opposite of that. Got it. This is a satire. First and foremost thing that you have to remember about Canterbury Tale is that it is a satire, a social satire. So if someone is said to be good, and he is actually exactly opposite of that. Got it. Yeah. Of all battles he fought, none were secular wars. They were all religious wars. Let me tell you about knight. He says that he's very chivalrous. Very courteous, adventurous, and all. He has fought in many battles. Wherever he has gone, there he had fought for something. Okay. But let me tell you, being a knight, he's supposed to fight for his country, isn't it? You might have seen many English movies. What are the actually common characteristic of a knight? Rescuing damsels, engaging in fight, protecting commoners, isn't it? These are the qualities of a knight. But this person has mostly engaged in religious wars. Now, the next person is squire. Squire is actually the son of knight. Okay, he's a son of knight, and he's taking lessons to become a knight. He's attending. He's going to become a knight. Then, look at his dressing style. He's wearing dress usually worn by women. Embroidered like a meadow bright dress. His gown was short and sleeves long and wide. Then let me tell you. Actually, he says that he's very brave. He pretends that he's very brave, but actually he's mostly interested in taking care of his locks, hair, meticulous. He's very much conscious about his appearance. Unlike knight and squires, this person is very much interested in taking care of his lock, very conscious about his appearance. Okay. Then 24/7, he spends his time in singing, writing poetry, horse riding, dancing, and all. And this person, instead of taking lessons on battles and fencing, he always fought on behalf of his lady. Actually, he's wooing a lady. He's a too good lover. But too good in, sorry, he's too bad in fighting and all. Okay. Then he follows his father. I told you, Squire is the son of knight. Actually, he doesn't have any manly qualities. This person doesn't have any manly qualities. He's an effeminate version. Okay. He dresses just like that of a lady. And he's very conscious about his appearance. He spends his time in playing flute, serenading ladies, likes poetry and horse riding. Okay, so that's all about Squire. Now, Yeoman is another character. So, let me tell you, during those times, servants, maids, etc., they will be imitating their masters, which you will study in MEG2, British drama, in interludes and all. You will study that in detail. Yeoman is the servant of Squire and Knight. I told you Squire and Knight are father and son. And Yeoman is the servant of Squire and Knight. And he has accompanied them. Simply accompanied them. So dress. So he has imitated the Squire and Knight. He has dressed in the same way how they have dressed. See. Now, Yeoman belong to the peasant class. He carries a sword and a dagger and a hunting horn. Then he is dressed in, he had a coat and a hood of green. Then he also carried a bracelet as a shield guard from the bow. And along with that, he also has a medal of Saint Christopher. Then what has been mentioned about? See, so many, I hope you can see this. Details, if you want, you can take a screenshot. And he is very, serious. Just like, see, as he imitates Squire and Knight, he pretends to be very serious. Okay.
Ma'am, can I ask you one doubt?
Yes, ask me.
Ma'am, when you were talking about the three good characters in this tale, you mentioned about Yeoman or Plowman?
Plowman. Yeoman is actually serves as a foil to Knight and Squire. Actually, Yeoman is the servant of Knight and Squire, right? So he'll be imitating his masters. If they are good, their servants are also good. If they are bad, then their servants are very bad.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. So this person acts as a woodsman. Okay. Even though he's a servant, he's fit for a job in woods. He's pretty good in hunting and all. Now, next character is Prioress. She's a nun. Belong to clergy class. So let me tell you something. In 14th century, many wealthy people have lost their status and they were forced to leave the place and they were, it would be impossible for the ladies to mingle with the commoners, isn't it? See, in 1970s in India, so many wealthy families have lost their properties, right? Due to some reason. There are dominant classes, residual classes, isn't it? Dominant and residual. So sometimes those one class which has been dominant in a particular period, after some time, they won't be dominant. They might have lost their power. Similarly, Prioress, she was very wealthy once. But due to some reason, families, wealthy, upper class family, they have lost their privilege. They have lost their authorities. For that reason, they were forced to leave their hometown and go somewhere else. But it will be truly impossible for ladies from noble class to mingle with downtrodden. Is it possible for the noble ladies to mingle with downtrodden? No, it is not possible. So what they did is they joined monasteries. It's the best way for those noble ladies is to join monastery. Actually, all those ladies who have joined monastery, they haven't joined there not out of religious reason or due to dedication or something else. They have taken those place as a shelter, a temporary shelter. Have you understood what I'm trying to say? Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
That is a temporary shelter for upper class ladies. I told you monastery or what do you call it? These type of churches are simply a temporary shelter for upper class ladies. Just because they can't go anywhere else, this is the best place. So the way she is a nun now, prioress. Her real name is Madame Eglantine. Anyway, I haven't included here. If you open the textbook and read the lines, you will get her name. Her name is Madame Eglantine. Yeah, she's a nun, and she's wearing a veil. Her clocks very graceful one, and she also has a bracelet made out of jewels and precious gems. Then she's very beautiful. Her features, her facial features are very well defined. Then let me tell you something. When she eats something, she takes a great care so that no food particle is fallen from her mouth. Actually, she has a very good idea about table manners. She knows table manners very well. She won't, when she eats something, she won't open her mouth wide. She won't open her mouth. She will slowly open her mouth, and she will take a great care to put the food particles inside her mouth, and she will close it without making any crushing or grinding sound. She will eat it slowly in a graceful manner, and she will also take a great pain so that no food particle is falling from her mouth and stain her dress. Okay. So she's very conscious about table manners. So what does it show about her? Is she a prioress? Is she really meant for this profession? What do you think? What do you think?
It shows about her upbringing as a noble lady.
Yeah. Actually, she's not meant for this profession. And yeah, she cannot withstand the cry of a mouse that has been caught in a trap. And she keeps three small hounds in with her. She had three small hounds with her, which she treated very gently and tenderly. Now, she also wears a brooch. I'm sorry, I haven't included that detail in the slide. And the brooch carries the inscription, Amor Vincit Hominia, AMORVINCIT, Hominia, Amor Vincit Hominia. Let me tell you, prioress is very important. You have to study. You have to study this part. Amor Vincit Hominia. So she wore a gold brooch with an inscription, Amor Vincit Hominia, meaning is love conquers all. So what does it mean? She is secretly longing for a worldly life, isn't it? Even though she is a nun now, she wanted to live a worldly life, isn't it? I repeat the characteristics of prioress. She is very delicate. She is very very coy. Then her real name is Madame Eglantine. Madame Eglantine. And she is from a noble class who lost her power, and that has made her to join monastery. Okay, she's very courteous, too conscious about table manners. She imitates all those Parisian manners. She speaks fluent French. Okay, she can speak French. Actually, clergy people are supposed to speak Latin, right? Latin. You know that point. Clergy people are supposed to use Latin, but she speaks French. Now, and she also had three hounds. She cannot stand the pain. She could not stand the pain and would cry if she sees a mouse or something like that caught in a trap. She's very delicate, just like the princess and queen mentioned in the stories. Now I'm moving on to the next character, that is Monk. Monk is the next important character. All these characters are very important, okay? That is why I'm describing in detail. The next character is Monk. He also belongs to the clergy class, that is ecclesiastical class, church class. Yeah, very wealthy, and he is, see the dressing, fine fur trimmed robe, very gaudy dress. Usually monk and friars, they are supposed to lead a life by begging, isn't it? Monks and friars, how they are supposed to live? Usually they collect alms, charity, isn't it? They collect things from people, and how they and that is the way how they lead a life. But this person is very wealthy, finely dressed. He's bald, fat, loves hunting. You know what's his favorite food? His favorite food is roasted swan, and he keeps hunting dog. See, he's a monk, still he keeps hunting dogs, isn't it? Now, and he is an outrider. See, if you're going to meet this person, he won't be there in the monastery. He'll be somewhere out. Now, yes. Next character is Friar. Next important character is Friar. He too belongs to wealthy class, that is clergy. Actually, these friars are not meant to be that rich, but our friar is very rich. Okay. Now, he has dressed like a pope. He's only a friar is someone who has low rank in church, but this person, a normal priest. But this person has dressed like a pope. He sang well, and he plays that hurdy-gurdy, and this person is truly immoral, okay? He has helped many ladies in getting married. This person has helped many girls in getting married, but only after putting them in trouble. Have you understood? Actually, he is not that familiar with the monastery, churches, or charity houses in England. But he is pretty familiar with inns and other ill-famed houses of England. Have you understood the character of this person?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. His name is Hubert. H-U-B-E-R-T. Hubert. Hubert. He is a womanizer. I repeat, he is a womanizer. Alcoholic. Even though he's a friar, he's not that linked with church or charity houses or something like that. But this person is very much in touch with inns and ill-famed houses of England. Now, next one. This character is not that important. Next character is merchant. Not that important, but let's have a look. Yeah. Belong to the wealthy class. Middle class, okay. Well, even though he's wealthy, since they are doing business and all, they belong to the merchant class. He's colorfully dressed, multicolored dressing. Then he has a forking beard. Then he travels on a horse. Then, see, he always talks about the profit that he had made in business. Very talkative, very boasting type. But let me tell you, this person is actually in debt. He says that he's a great merchant of of England, but this person is actually in debt. Next character is Oxford cleric. First virtuous character. This person is virtuous. Good character. So belong to the middle class. And yeah, he was a student at Oxford, and he is extremely thin. Very thin. Not like other. See, all the clergy characters, ecclesiastical characters are fair and fat. Okay. They are very fair, fat. But this one is very thin. And he rode a very thin horse, and his clothes were threadbare. He preferred to buy books rather than clothes and food. Even if he's getting money from his friends, he will use that money to buy books and clothes. Okay. He did not talk often, but when he did, it was with great dignity and moral virtue. He's not that talkative. Okay, just like other clergy characters. Actually, clergy characters are, most of the clergy characters are hedonistic, Epicurean characters. Eat, drink, and be merry. Okay, please note it. All clergy characters are hedonistic, Epicurean character. But this person is very reserved. He won't talk too much. I mean, the money that he gets from his friends, he spends on books. He's not that interested in buying clothes and other gaudy things. He seeks morality and virtue, the first virtuous character in Canterbury Tales. Now I'm moving on to the next man of law. Sergeant of law, or the man of law, he's a lawyer, belong to the clergy class appointed by the king. Then about him, let me tell you, he pretends that he is very wise. He appears to be busier, wiser than he really is. He always talks about the cases. Similarly, just like the lawyers and celebrated lawyers of the present, he appears to be wiser and busier than he really is. He's very cunning, okay? The next character is Franklin. Franklin is a large landowner. He doesn't have a noble birth. He spends his money freely, enjoying good wine and company. Okay. He's a glutton. This person is a glutton. He loves eating. His house was always open, and he was true Epicurean, devoting his energy to fine living, and was generally liked by other pilgrims. I told you what's the main character of this person. He is a glutton. He loves eating. Now, next set of characters. Tradesman or haberdasher. Tradesman, carpet maker, haberdasher, dyer, carpenter, weaver. They are working class people. Emerging class people. Have you understood? They are the emerging class. I told you. 14th century England has witnessed many changes due to the fall of feudalism. Actually, feudalism, that was the last stage of feudalism. England was witnessing the last stage of feudalism. It has almost fallen, and has the dominant class as now going to become the what? In short, they will become the residual. And which one is going to be the dominant class? Working class or merchant class is going to become the dominant class from 14th century onwards. So this one, they are the emerging class. Middle class are the emerging class. Let me tell you, authors of the 19th and 18th century, they despised middle class. According to the authors, philosophers, and other writers, you know which who are most vicious, cunning, and ambitious? Which class is very ambitious? Tell me, upper class, middle class, or lower class? Which class is the most ambitious class?
Middle class.
Yeah, middle class. That is why authors, philosophers, writers, all those people despised middle class. Actually, upper class people, they just want to mention their status. Oh, we are rich. We just wanted to mention the status. And lower class people, they wanted something to eat. Okay, this day has passed. Tomorrow, we don't know. We would be grateful if we get something to eat. That is their attitude. But middle class people, they wanted to improve their status. Every now and then, they are working hard. They will do anything to attain their target. Okay. So actually, these people work as a foil between upper class and lower class. That is why they are said to be the emerging class. Okay, let's see more about the social class of this, social status of this people. Anyway, all these characters, carpet maker, haberdasher, dyer, carpenter, weaver. See, they have dressed in uniform. They dressed in uniform, and they all of them have carried knives with them. And they are very proud that they are representing a class, okay, since they are the emerging class. Don't you know that all you can easily identify upstarts. I mean, upstart people from upstart. Those who have recently gained wealth. They are popularly known as upstarts. So you can easily identify them. How can you identify them? They'll be dressing they'll be dressed in Gaudi style, isn't it? Shining dress and all. Wearing all the jewels. Similarly, these people are very proud of their appearance. And they are accompanied by a cook. They have taken a cook along with them. Let's see. Social status. He belongs to the trade class. And this person is going to pilgrimage on a particular purpose because he has a sore on a leg. So cook is the servant of that tradesman. He knows everything. See, he knows how to boil, bake, roast, and fry. Then, actually, he's a too good cook. But the only thing is he had a running sore on his leg. Next one is the shipman. Shipman belongs to the peasant class. He's a sailor. He's good in everything. Actually, he knows ports from Mediterranean to Baltic. He knows almost all ports of the world. He knows everything. Then he could even read the stars and knew how to. And he is too good in fighting. He knows everything, but he doesn't know how to ride a horse. He's too good in all art forms. Everything he is good, but he doesn't know how to ride a horse. When he sits on a horse, he's just like a fish out of water. Okay. Now, doctor of physic. He too belongs to the middle class. Very interesting. Actually, more than human physics, what he knows is astrology. Okay, he had actually by seeing the people, he can predict what they are suffering from. Normally, a doctor will understand ailment of a person by after examining him, isn't it? After checking his condition only, they will come to know what they are suffering from. But this person can easily predict what they are suffering from just because he's too good in astrology. Okay. And
excuse me, ma'am.
Yeah.
Sorry for interrupting, but is this physic the same as today's PHYSIQUE?
Yes, exactly. But spelling, I told you, okay. spelling is entirely different. My dear, this is Middle English. So spelling is different. Okay.
Okay, thank you.
And he has got a special love for gold. Whenever a patient comes to him, he will describe gold. You have to take gold like that. You know why? It has a special. We know that gold in some level is prescribed as a medicine, isn't it? In Ayurvedam and all, gold in some level is prescribed for some diseases. But this person, whoever comes to him, he will prescribe gold as a medicine. Okay. Just because he has got a special love for yellow metal. And this person had made a lot of money during plague. I told you during Chaucer's time, England was swept thrice by bubonic plague. And England's population was reduced to 1/3 due to plague. Many people died due to plague. At that time, this person reaped a lot of money. Got it? He made a lot of money during that time. So you might have understood his character very well. What type of person he is, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. He did not read Bible very much. He's healthy, but unhealthy in spirit. He's an unhealthy, not that religious. Okay. He's going to Canterbury Shrine of Thomas Becket just wanted, all are going, oh, come on, let's go and see what's happening there. He's going for that purpose. Understood. All are going to Canterbury, so I'm also going. That's all. Not out of any religious reason. And let me tell you one more thing. People say that he is in deal with druggist, pharmacist. Okay. This person, he's a doctor, right? So normally, just like the present contemporary world, every doctors, there are a lot of pharmaceuticals right now, isn't it? A lot of MNCs right now. So doctors are in league with pharmacists. Just like that, this doctor in 14th century, he was in league with druggist. So like that also, he made a lot of money. This character is very important. Class, please note this. Wife of Bath. Or Wifi of Bath. Wifi. Modern English, wife of Bath. Middle English, Wifi of Bath. Social status. She is a seamstress. Then she had a kerchief. Very expensive kerchief. Weighed a pound. Okay. That was an beautifully... embellished with gems. Then she has married 5 times and she outlived all her 5 husbands. I hope you have understood her character. Her special talent was her knowledge of all remedies of love, and she is quick in, she loves giving advice on love. Okay. Why she is going to Canterbury, you know, she is partially deaf. This wife of Bath is partially deaf. She's very meek. Whenever church is holding something, she'll be there in the front row of altar. Okay.
Krishna, hello. Yes.
Yeah, ma'am.
Okay. അന്ന് ജസ്റ്റ് ഒന്ന് കണ്ടേ ഉള്ളൂ, സംസാരിച്ചേ ഉള്ളൂ. സോ മൈ ഡിയർ ലേണേഴ്സ്, ആരെങ്കിലും ഒരാളൊന്ന് അൺമ്യൂട്ട് ചെയ്യൂ. അപ്പൊ നിങ്ങള് ക്ലാസ്സുകൾ നടന്നുകൊണ്ടിരിക്കുന്നു. ഞാൻ അന്ന് പറഞ്ഞ പോലെ ഇപ്പൊ ഗ്രൂപ്പ് ഞാൻ കണ്ടു, പക്ഷെ ഗ്രൂപ്പില് യു ക്യാൻ ആഡ് കൃഷ്ണപ്രിയ ഓൾസോ. ദെൻ പറഞ്ഞ പോലെ രണ്ടോ മൂന്നോ അഡ്മിൻസ് ആവാം ഫ്രം സ്റ്റുഡൻസ്, രണ്ടുപേരോ മറ്റും നിന്നോളൂ. കാരണം എന്തെങ്കിലും മെസ്സേജ് പാസ് ചെയ്യണമെങ്കിലേ നിങ്ങളെ ആക്കാം. നെക്സ്റ്റ് വീക്ക് വിൽ ഹാവ് എ ഗൂഗിൾ മീറ്റ് കേട്ടോ. അപ്പോ വിൽ ക്ലാരിഫൈ ഓൾ ദ ഡൗട്ട്സ് വിത്ത് റിഗാർഡ് ടു അസൈൻമെന്റ്സ്, ടേം ആൻഡ് എക്സാമിനേഷൻ എക്സെട്ര. നിങ്ങൾ അറേഞ്ച് ചെയ്തിപ്പോ എന്നോട് പറഞ്ഞാ മതി എപ്പോഴാണെന്നുള്ളത് കേട്ടോ. ഗ്രൂപ്പില് മാക്സിമം ആൾക്കാര് പിന്നെ എന്ത് ചെയ്യാ, എന്നാലും ഗ്രൂപ്പിൽ ജോയിൻ ചെയ്യുക, എന്നാലേ എന്തെങ്കിലും കാര്യങ്ങൾ പറയണമെങ്കിൽ പറ്റുള്ളൂ. ദെൻ അനദർ തിങ് യു ക്യാൻ സീ, ഓൾ ഓഫ് യു ആർ നോട്ട് ഗെറ്റിംഗ് ദി SMS മെസ്സേജ്. ഐ തിങ്ക് ദാറ്റ്സ് എ പ്രോബ്ലം വെൻ ബൾക്ക് SMS ഇസ് സെൻഡ് ഫ്രം ഓഫീസ്. അപ്പൊ ആദ്യം ആർക്കാണോ കിട്ടുന്നത് വെച്ച് കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ ആ ആള് ഒന്ന് ഗ്രൂപ്പിലിടുക SMS. ആർക്കും നിരക്കില്ല, ഒരാളിട്ടാ മതി, പിന്നെ ഇടരുത്. ആർക്കാ കിട്ടുന്ന വെച്ചാൽ ആ ആള്, ചിലപ്പോ ഞാൻ തന്നെ ഇടും, ഞാൻ മറന്നുപോയാലും നിങ്ങള് ആ ലിങ്ക്, ഒരാഴ്ചത്തെ 2 ലിങ്ക് ഉണ്ടാവും. 1 will be ഇപ്പൊ ഓൾറെഡി ആയി കഴിഞ്ഞു, അതുകൊണ്ട് ഇനിയിപ്പോ മാറ്റാനില്ല. ഈ മാസത്തെ എല്ലാ ലിങ്കും ആയി കഴിഞ്ഞു. ആരെങ്കിലും ഒരാള് ഹിയർ ഷീ ക്യാൻ പുട്ട് ദ ലിങ്ക് ഇൻ ദ ഗ്രൂപ്പ്. അപ്പൊ കുട്ടികളെങ്കിൽ പിന്നെ എല്ലാവർക്കും മറന്നു പോകും, അതാണോ MEG 1 ആണോ MEG 3 ആണോ എന്നൊക്കെ ഉള്ളത്. ഓക്കെ, അപ്പൊ ശരി കൃഷ്ണ, ഞാൻ അതൊന്ന് പറയാൻ വേണ്ടിട്ടായിരുന്നു. വി ക്യാൻ ഹാവ് എ ഗൂഗിൾ മീറ്റ്, കൃഷ്ണ ക്യാൻ ഓൾസോ പാർട്ടിസിപ്പേറ്റ് ഇൻ ദാറ്റ്. അതെ, അടുത്ത ആഴ്ച ഒരു ദിവസം വെക്കാൻ പറയാം. ഞാൻ ഈ ആഴ്ച മുഴുവൻ അപ് ടു 12th, 13th വി ആർ ഹാവിംഗ് എക്സാം. ഓൺലി ആഫ്റ്റർ എക്സാമിനേഷൻ ഐ വിൽ ബി ഫ്രീ എന്നാണ്. ഒരു 7:30 അങ്ങനെ വെക്കുകയാണെങ്കിൽ യുവർ കൺവീനിയൻസ് ഓൾസോ. കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ എനിക്ക് കുഴപ്പമില്ല. So one of the group admins can do that. Okay, you can arrange, and you have to get the permission from myself, Anita ma'am, and Krishnapriya ma'am. എന്നിട്ട് ഞങ്ങളുടെ സൗകര്യം കൂടെ നോക്കിയിട്ട് വേണം വെക്കാനായിട്ട്. ഓക്കെ, എന്നാൽ നമുക്ക് എല്ലാ കാര്യങ്ങളും ക്ലിയർ ക്ലാരിഫൈ ചെയ്യാം കേട്ടോ. ഓക്കെ, ശരി എന്നാ. ഓക്കെ,
okay class, please add me in the group so that I can forward notes, so I can also clear your doubts. Now so yeah, about wife of Bath, I told you
partially, it's very mixed.
Hello, yeah. Are you trying to say something? Yes, tell me.
No ma'am, I was just saying we were discussing about she being very meek, that point.
Yeah. So see, even though she had married 5 times and outlived her for 5 husbands, she's very humble, she's very coy. Okay, you understood. she always behaves that as if she's already she's at 16. Okay. She made a point of being first at the altar or offering in church. She's too good in offering. Then she had been to she has been to many places, and on pilgrimages to Jerusalem, Rome, etc., etc., and she has got a gap tooth. Gap tooth. This lady is going to Canterbury Tales, Shrine of Canterbury, just because she is deaf. She's deaf. Do you know why people approach approach wife of Bath? Just because she had a special talent in giving advice regarding love related, love and marriage related issues. Understood? A special talent. Now next character is Parson. I mean the most virtuous one in the Canterbury Tale. Not it, it's Parson. If you're getting a question, if you're getting a if you're going for some competitive exam, and if they are asking you who's the virtuous character, you can write Parson. So he belonged to the clergy class. He's very modest, even though he's a clergyman, he's very very poor. Then even though he's poor, he's rich in holy thoughts. He would give his money to poor parishioners. See, rest of the clergy people are looting people. See, monk, friar, prioress, priest, etc., they are looting people. Actually, okay, but this person, he gives his scarcely money that he had made, that he is ready to give to parishioners, poor parishioners. Then next character is Plowman. Plowman is the brother of Parson. Once again, Plowman. He's also good-hearted, just like his brother. Then he's a farmer who lives in perfect peace. He loves all people with his heart. Then he also promptly pays his part to tithes to church, not like other people. Okay, other people are taking money from church or people, but this person gives money to
ma'am
church.
Sorry, yeah. Unable to see the screen sharing.
Okay one second, I will try to share it again. Excuse me, I'll share it again. Okay, one second. Can you see the slides now?
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, yeah. So So I told you Plowman is the brother of Parson. Don't forget that. Plowman is the brother of Parson. He is also as good as his brother. Got it? And he works very hard, and he, just like his brother, he gives his money to parishioners and to the church. Okay. That's all about Plowman. The next character is Miller. Miller, he belongs to the trade class. Okay. Then he had a wart on his nose. Then he's very stout, but he is very short. Stout and short. Then he's a wrestler. His temper is very bad. Then he played a bagpipe as the pilgrim left the town. Okay, he's the one who played pipe. Not that important. And let me tell you, he's not a believer. He's a non-believer. He is going to, just like doctor, he doesn't have any particular reason, even though he has a wart on his nose. See, all people are going to Canterbury Tales just because they had some kind of disease and they just want, they want to heal their disease. But this person, he doesn't believe in Thomas Becket and all. See, all are going. So let me see what quality that shrine is having. Let me go and check. You got it. That person is going to test the power of Thomas Becket. Miller. It's a non-believer. Blasphemous. This person is a blasphemer. I hope you know the meaning of a blasphemer. Whom do we call a blasphemer? Hello?
Someone who goes
or disrespect the religion.
Yeah, one who goes. Yeah, yes, exactly. So he doesn't believe in any kind of church related things. Now, the next character is Mansiple. So Mansiple, he's a steward at a low house, low school. Okay. Now, he was in charge of purchasing food for those people, students in low house. He was not as learned as lawyers, but he is very clever than lawyers. Okay, let me tell you, he is a steward. He was a servant. He's a servant at a low school. And his job is to get materials, food for the school. He's not that as educated as the teachers and students of the low school, but he's pretty clever than them. Got it. So he was shrewd in buying that he had been able to put aside some money for himself. Even though he's buying food for them, he's pretty enough to, good enough to make money out of it. Now, next character is Reeve. So Reeve, he belongs to the middle class. He's the manager of a large estate. He's a very skinny man. His temper is very bad. Then he has got a thin legs. He was an able, efficient, manager. He's very shrewd. He has reaped many rewards from his masters. Then he's a favorite of his employers, but he's a dreadful nightmare of his employees. Okay. He's too good with rich people, but he's a nightmare to his slaves, herdsmen, workers. You know, he knows to handle the situation. He knows how to behave with each. Now, next character is Summoner. Summoner, actually, this person is also a clergyman, and he brings those accused people, those sinners to the church. Those people who has been excommunicated by the church, or those people who has done some mistake or gone against the church. His duty is to bring those people to the church court. Church has his own court during 14th century. Okay. So this person in charge of bringing those accused people to the court. Now, this person has leprosy. To make the matter worse, he eats onion, garlic, and all other food items that is harmful to his condition. He's also an alcoholic, lecherous. See, he's a summoner. He's a clergyman. Still, see his characters. I mean, his features. Oh, sorry, sorry. Extremely sorry. Yeah. Now, just like the friar, he is also associated with those ladies of ill reputation. I hope you know. I hope you have understood. Ladies of ill reputation. I mean, he is very much in touch with brothels and all. Okay, Samana is happy to go to the brothels and other inns. Next character is partner. Actually, partner, just like the summoner, is very much corrupted. Partner, he has got an official authority from Rome to sell the pardons. Actually, he sells pardons to the sinners. You know what is a pardon? It's a pamphlet carrying religious relics, religious stuff. So this person has got authority from Rome to sell those pamphlets, religious pamphlets to the sinners. So when the sinners, when they read these religious relics, of course they will get some atonement, isn't it? They will, yeah, they will feel to sacrifice. So they will feel to repent. So for that only, partner is selling, and mostly partner is selling what? Pamphlets or religious relics to people. But this person is selling to make money. He, his bag is full of pamphlets, religious things. Okay. And he will sing song in such a way. He had a very loud, high-pitched voice, yellow hairs. And he will sing and frighten people and make them buy his pamphlets. You understood what type of person? Actually, he is not doing his profession. Instead, he takes it as a business. He forces common people to buy his pamphlet. So he, in that case, he's not a clergyman. He's actually a businessman. Okay. He's a fake who makes money in exchanging. And he's quick in giving pardon to those people who gives him money. You got him. You got his character. What sort of a person he is?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Actually, we know that it's pretty difficult to get pardon from the church for doing immoral things. But this person, he will easily, he easily forgives to people who gives him money. That's a particular special, I mean, that is a specialty about the partner. So that's all about the 29 characters. Let me tell you one thing. Our prioress, I hope you remember the prioress, Madame Eglantine. She has got a nun. She is accompanied by a nun. And in turn, that nun is accompanied by three priests. Actually, the three priests are not that important, but the story told by one of the priests is very important, which is included in your syllabus. Okay. So, and so we have covered the 29 characters. Now, after the 29 character, now we are going to discuss Harry Bailey. I mean, the host of the Tabard Inn. Those 29 pilgrim plus Chaucer, they have took what? They have actually they have lodged in the inn run by host Harry Bailey. Okay, actually he is the person who suggested that each one should tell a story on their way to Canterbury Tales and way back home. And he is the one who promised them that he'll be rewarding them a free meal. And apart from that, he also told them that he'll be accompanying them. He will be accompanying them. So let me tell you, after this decision, there had been a feud among those pilgrims about telling the tales. Okay, I will tell the story first. So when the feud started, they have decided to take a lot. So the one that draws smallest straw will tell the story first. So it is the knight who told the story first. Anyway, that is not included in the syllabus. Only character description is important. Prologue is basically about the character description. Have you understood? Don't mix with the Canterbury, entire Canterbury Tale. Canterbury Tale is a pretty long work. You don't have to study that. You only need to study the character description of 29 pilgrims. Got it? Now, moving on to runners. Actually, Canterbury Tales comprises many literary runners. I told you there are, it's a story within a story, 24 tales. And 24 tales belongs to different runners. Some are courtly romance, some are fabliau, some are exemplum, some are allegory, some are fables, some tales are sermon, religious composition, like that. Now, exemplum is introduce a moral message. Moral message, it will have some religious elements in it. Here in this Canterbury Tales, Pardon's Tale is an exemplum. Then tales told by knight, squire, etc. are courtly romance. Knight's Tale, Wife of Bard's Tale, etc. are courtly romance. I hope you know what a romance is. Courtly romances. Now, fable. What is an allegory? Allegory is a tale in which vices and virtues are personified. Haven't you seen Aesop? I think you are familiar with Aesop's Fable. Hello, class. Are you familiar with Aesop's Fable?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Where animals can speak, isn't it? Animals speak, think, and act like human beings. That is an allegory. So, wise and virtuous characters are personified there. So, like that, the one that we are going to study, Nun Priest Tale. Nun Priest Tale is a beast fable. Please remember that Nun Priest Tale is a fable. Then fabliau is a show story with snappy ending. Snappy ending means modern movies have got a snappy ending. Somewhat irritating, pleasant, but still cold ending. Miller's Tale, Reeve's Tale, Merchant's Tale, etc. belong to fabliau. Then sermon is a religious treaty. Okay, it's a religious poem or religious tale with a moral story. So about, I told you, Canterbury Tale is a social commentary. First and foremost, it's a satire. Chaucer actually ridicules, satirizes the English society of 14th century for various reasons. I mean, almost all his characters are very much corrupted in some other way. Okay. They are not true to their the characters that they show in front of others. Now, yeah, so about this belongs to many runners. Courtly romance, fabliau, exemplum, allegory, beast fable, sermon, religious compositions. Now, personifications. See, I told you different characters. Gluttony is represented by which character? I told you. Do you remember which character is a glutton? Franklin is a glutton. So are those people?
Merchant?
No. It is Franklin who eats. Who loves to eat? Isn't it? He has a store of food. Then, avarice, monk, friar, summoner, partner, they represent slow. Some are very lazy. Lust, wife of Bath, monk, friar, lusty characters. Vanity, shunned by vanity, tradesmen. See, they are emerging class. Still, they are dressed in dressed very godly. Then anger, represented by Miller, shipman. So, seven deadly sins, actually it is mentioned in Bible, or those people who are from ecclesiastical background, I think they are familiar with these things. So, actually, gluttony, these are vices, seven deadly sins. I hope you are familiar with that. Gluten, greed, sloth is lazy, lust, vanity, pride, anger. So, these qualities, we cannot say these are qualities, but these vices are actually represented by 29 characters. 20 each. I mean, each of the 29 characters represent these qualities. I mean, these vices. Now, some other characters: moderation, generosity, diligence, love, modesty, humility, and forgiveness. See, parson, plowman, and clerk. They represent these qualities, isn't it? Clerk, Oxford clerk represent moderation. Diligence. He represent that two qualities, moderation and diligence. Whereas plowman and parson represents generosity, modesty, humility, and forgiveness. Are you able to understand what I'm trying to say? Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, yeah. Ma'am, can I ask? I mean, those things, yeah, yeah. You please ask me. Please ask me. Yes, you can ask me.
Ma'am, we have, we have characterized the characters of a parson, plowman, and Oxford cleric. Ma'am, yeah. In which category we can bring host, which means Harry Bailey?
Harry Bailey is entirely different. He is simply the one who judges the story that they are telling.
Okay.
Okay. He has no major role in this Canterbury. Chaucer is only a narrator. Whatever he sees, he says that. Only that 29 pilgrims have main role in Canterbury Tales. Okay.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
So except that three characters, except out of 29 characters, 26 are vice. They are bad characters. Malicious characters, greedy characters. So they represent gluttony, avarice, sloth, lust, vanity, pride, anger mentioned in Bible. But plowman, parson, and cleric, clerk. They represent moderation, generosity, diligence, love, modesty, humility, and forgiveness. Have you understood? So actually, don't take the 29 characters as simply characters. Actually, they represent bad and good qualities in society. Got it? I hope you
understand. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Please take the screenshot of this. Please take the screenshot of this.
Yes, ma'am, we have taken. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, next one. Major themes of Canterbury: love, sex, fraternity, power of church, betrayal, rivalry, then religion, gender, etc. The major themes: love, squire, sex by friar, wife of Bath, fraternity, brotherhood group is that tradesman group. Haberdasher, dyer, carpenter, they represent fraternity because they are uniformly dressed and they are very proud to present themselves in the front of society. Then power of the church is represented by the ecclesiastical character, betrayal, wife of Bath. Then rivalry, of course, that Miller and Reeve had a rivalry between them. Then religion, gender, etc. are the major themes of Canterbury. Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, rhyming scheme and meter. Rhyming scheme and meter of Canterbury Tales. So the rhyming scheme of the poem, I told you this is a poem written in heroic couplet. We have already discussed that. So one of you told me that you are from a non-literature background. So this poem is written in heroic couplet, my dear. Hello? Is she still present?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, my dear. So this one, our Canterbury Tale is written in heroic couplet. So heroic couplet is nothing but rhymed iambic pentameter. Mm-hmm. Rhymed iambic. Have you seen the U-type sign? U-type sign. Can you see this?
Yes, ma'am.
This is unstressed. And this one is stressed. Okay, this dash type sign is stressed. So unstressed, okay, followed by a stressed is said to be an iamb. So like that, there will be five iambs in a line. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Like that, you'll be having five iambs. If there are five, then it is said to be iambic pentameter. If there are only three, then it is said to be iambic trimeter. If there are four, iambic tetrameter. If there is only one iamb, then it is monometer. If it is 6, hexameter. If it is 7, Alexandrine. If there are 7, it is said to be Alexandrine. Okay, so like this, see, let me tell you, the, we don't have any special rule in dividing this thing into food. Actually, it is the way how we pronounce it. Sometimes we will divide this according to our convenience, so as to get IM. Okay, in more, if you are taking this poem in modern way, it will be impossible for you to divide in particular. I told you this pronunciation is entirely different, and especially from every shire's end. Of England to Canterbury, they went. See, W-E, can you see this? W-E-N-D-E?
Yes, ma'am.
That is modern went. Okay, we will, so the meter that Chaucer used in writing Canterbury Tale is iambic pentameter. Don't forget that. When you write when you write the essay, or if you, even if you are writing annotation, please include that. This poem is written in iambic pentameter. Don't forget that. And also remember, see, if you're getting few lines from Canterbury Tales, blindly you may divide the line into 5. Divide like this. Have you understood? Unstressed followed by a stress. It doesn't have any rules.
Remember, where to demarcate it, like, you know, where to divide it, like, and special. Why is that line drawn between specially SP separated from CILLY? How do we come across that?
What is a syllable? What is a syllable? Anyway, you will study that in MEG4. Let me ask you, what is a syllable? A syllable,
few words, few letters, but with the vowel sound.
Yeah, it will have at least one vowel. Not at least one vowel, a vowel. A vowel will be there. So once you get a vowel, just see whether it is stressed or unstressed. And. Is it stressed? Is it stressed? No, it is not stressed. And. Specially, specialist, per. It is stressed, isn't it? So since you are getting one vowel here, we marked. We need only, we need only 2 syllables. Unstressed followed by a stress is an IM. We got 2, we marked 1. Shelly. Lee is stressed more than she, isn't it? Like that. So in a syllable, we will have only one vowel. Okay. So once you get a vowel, mark whether it is stressed or unstressed. It doesn't have any particular rule. Okay. It is the way we pronounce it. If it is stressed, you will mark a dash type sign. If it is not stressed, just put a U.
Fine.
Now, anyway, Canterbury Tale, the entire poem is written in heroic couplet, same way, iambic pentameter. Now, please take a screenshot. Now, it's not possible to read the entire poem. Still, we can read a few lines. 1 second. What's the time now? I need to wind up. Oh. Okay. I'm reading this. This is mod. Can you see the poem?
Yes, ma'am.
Middle English and this is modern English. I'm just reading it. The few lines. Okay. One that April with his shower sooty, the drafty of March that pierced to rooty and bathed every vein in sweet liquor of which virtue gendered its flower. One that suffered as eek with his sweater breath, inspired hath in every halter heat and tendry corpse and young sonny. See the modern translation. When that April with his shower sweet, the drop of marsh has pierced to the root and bathed every vein in such liquor of which strength the flower is engendered. When the zephyr is also with sweet breath has inspired in every halt and heat. So when you read this poem, you should compare it with modern English. It's not a big deal at the end of your textbook. See, MEG1 text, if you open the text and if you turn back, you can see the modern English translation. So compare it and study. It won't be a big deal. I'm just telling you how to read this poem. Pronunciation is entirely different, but still you can relate. It's not that different. It's pretty easy to relate, right? See the spelling went. End. Launches, land. Shores, strands, shores. See, like that, some small differences are there. So let me tell you. I'm just telling you the first, only the first stanza. When that April with his showers, sweet, drought of March hath pierced to the root. So when the sweet showers of April fall and shoot down through the drought of March to the to pierce the root and bath every vein in such moisture, from which there spring fresh flowers. We know on which season, when did they decide to go for pilgrim? It's in the month of April, right? So April is the best season, season of spring, isn't it? So they started to go on pilgrimage in the month of April. That season was very sweet because the showers of the April has pierced to the root of March. I mean, March actually March is a bit hot, right? So after winter only, isn't it? Spring, we do have a poem like that, isn't it? If winter comes, can spring be far behind, isn't it? So after the winter season, spring has come and touched the land. It has awakened the entire nature, not only people, but also shrubs, plants, and animals. See, so April with its sweet showers, when it pierced to the land, actually it has moistened the trees and shrubs. Then young sun has run its half course. Young sun, see, have you seen this spelling? S-O-N-N-E, sun, sunny. That is sun. See this sunny and sun. When the zephyrus also with his sweet breath. See, what is zephyrus? Zephyrus is the west wind. Zephyrus is the west wind. Not only April with, and his, sweet showers of April that has moisted the fresh flowers and trees of earth, but also west wind also awakened the land with its sweet breath. Okay. At that time, sun is very young. Why did you say that sun is young? Because sun is still young in the month of April, isn't it? Now, so during the month of April, birds, they make melodies. How? They will sleep all night with their eyes open. According to the poet, people, not only people, entire world is very happy. Entire creatures of the world are very happy during the month of April. So nature will prick, birds who are sleeping with eyes open. So they will make music. Then this is the time that people go for pilgrimages to long distance lands. People from every nook and corners of England, they are heading to Canterbury. Why they are heading to Canterbury? To seek the blessing of blissful martyr. Who's the martyr? Thomas Becket. They are heading to Canterbury just because the particular place is very famous for healing qualities. Okay. Now, class, hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Right. See, it's not that difficult. This is the very beginning of Canterbury Tales. Soon after this, a description about night begins. Okay, after this line and description about night begins, maybe at first you will have some difficulty in reading, but if you compare it with the modern English, it won't be a big deal. I told you how to read this. Okay. The next one is I'm going to wind up after prologue to Canterbury Tales. Where start the tales from? Sorry. Please mute your mic. I'm getting distracted. Please mute your mic. So after this prologue to Canterbury, we have tales told by different characters. We have 24 tales told by different characters. And you don't have to study that 24 tales. Only one tale you have to study. That is non-priest tale. Which is it? Can you please mute the mic? The one who has switched on the mic. Please mute it. Okay. You don't have to study this. You have to study non-priest tale. That is included in your portion. This is a fable. And it is told by nuns, priest. Prioress is Madam Eglantine is accompanied by a nun, and she is in turn accompanied by three priests. One of the priests tells this tale. Actually, nun priest tale is of 626 lines. Okay, it is a mock epic. It is a mock epic, and apart from that, it is a fable. The main characters of the nun priest are Chanticleer. Chanticleer is a rooster. Pertie Lotley is a hen, and Duane Russell is a fox. Now, this tale actually blurs the boundary between human being and animal, because it is normally animals, it's the human beings who speak, isn't it? But in this tale, animals can speak, think, and act like human beings. Now, this is also a little bit misogynistic poem, just because it discusses about the issue of women's counsel, women's listening to taking women's advice. Okay, maybe you can say that this person is a little bit a male chauvinist, because critics has unleashed him for speaking against women. Okay, in this story also, he's actually ridiculing women. Okay, he's satirizing women and men who take their advice. Now, it also deals with the significance of dreams, themes of flattery and pride. So story of nun priest tale in a nutshell, it is, I'm going to tell you the story in a nutshell. So let me tell you, the story is told by nuns, priest. Long ago, there lived a widow and two daughters, and they were very poor. So they kept some cattle, a rooster and seven hen. See, rooster's name is Chanticleer. He was the master of seven hens. Okay, but his favorite wife was Lady Pertlotty. Okay, she held the heart of Chanticleer. So Chanticleer had a nightmare, and so he was groaning. So his wife Pertlotty, his favorite wife, asked him why he was very sad. So he told her that he had a nightmare in which he was caught by a fox. So she became very angry, and she told him that he had lost all her she had lost all her respect for her husband. Okay, Pertlotty is the hen. She is the hen, and Chanticleer is the rooster. Chanticleer has got seven wives. He's the master of seven hens, but his favorite wife's name is Pertlotty. So this Chanticleer had a nightmare one night, and the next day he was groaning because of that. So when Pertlotty asked, he told the truth that he had a nightmare. He was caught by a fox in his dream, and Pertlotty told him that, see, I had a dream. Something bad is going to happen. So Pertlotty became very angry. She told her husband that she had lost all her love and respect for husband, because she doesn't love a coward. And she told him that you had a bad dream just because you had eaten too much. You better take some laxative. You'll be okay. You have eaten too much. That is why you are seeing such kind of dreams. Chanticleer says that dreams has got significance. Actually, dreams are giving us some hints about the future. You have to believe in dreams. But Pertlotty says that dreams are absurd. A brave man like you shouldn't believe in dreams. Then Chanticleer tells two stories. One story is like this. Rooster, again telling a story. Let me tell you, Canterbury Tale itself is a story about storytelling. 29, Chaucer is telling us a story. Then Chaucer's characters are telling the story, and their characters are in turn telling a story. It's like a labyrinth, story about storytelling. Got it. So, yeah. So the rooster, that rooster is telling a story. Two people are going for a pilgrimage. When the night comes, one pilgrim, he got a lodge, but the other pilgrim, he hasn't got a lodging. So he took shelter in a barn. And the second one who has taken lodge in a barn, he was looted by some thieves, and he was murdered. And he appears in the dream of the pilgrim that has got shelter in the lodge. And he says that he was murdered, and next day he can see the body of the person in a cart outside the city. Okay. Anyway, that person at first he doesn't believe in the dream, but when the next day when he went to the barn and when he inquired about his friend, the barn owner says that he hasn't seen him in the morning. Then he went in search for his friend outside the barn, and outside the city gate, he has seen the body of his friend as he has seen in his dream. That is the first story told by the Chanticleer. The next story is, Chanticleer again says one story, so has to make his wife believe that dreams are significant. They are actually giving you some hints about the future or danger that is hidden in the future. That is, the second story is, some sailors are going for a journey, and one of the sailor had a dream that the ship is going to be drowned. Anyway, when he discussed with his friend, they satirized him. Okay, they laughed at him. But when they reached the middle of the sea, ship has wrecked and they all drowned. They were drowned to death. So in these two stories, dreams has actually come true. So what Chanticleer wants his wife to, he wants his wife to believe in dreams. Anyway, she was not ready. To believe in dreams, as recommended by her husband. Then next day, after some days, when Chanticleer was alone, while he was sitting on the branch of a tree, he saw a fox. Fox came and flattered Chanticleer that, he hasn't seen such a beautiful rooster in that part of the country. So he asked Chanticleer to sing. So Chanticleer believed in fox flattery. He has fallen in fox flattery. He started to sing. Once he started to sing, a fox has caught him. Okay. So his dream has come true, isn't it? In his dream, he has seen that fox caught him, and that has really happened. But our Chanticleer is very clever. Fox caught him and he started to run from that place. Hearing the cry of Chanticleer, his wives and cattle, bees, everything started to chase the fox. Even the widow and her daughter chased the fox. Okay. So seeing all this, Chanticleer told Rooster, see, entire women are chasing you. See, after all, you are a man. Why can't you throw some insult at those ladies? You're a man, right? Just throw some insult at those ladies. So Fox believed in that, and he opened the mouth so as to insult, cattle, hens, lady, and their daughters. So no sooner did he open his mouth than our Chanticleer escaped from his mouth, and he flew on the top of a tree and he settles there. Thereafter, he lives a happy, peaceful life. That is the story of Nun Priest Tale. So let me tell you, in this tale, I mean, nuns, priest, he actually ridicules the entire women race. Because Chanticleer, in order to convince his wife, he quotes a Latin phrase that which I will forward in the notes. In principio mulier est hominis confusio. The meaning of those lines is, woman is the man's sole bliss and joy. See, Chanticleer loves his wife very much. She also loves him, but she's not ready to believe in the dream that he has seen. So when she has gone away from him, he decided to convince her. That is why he told her, woman is the sole bliss of a man. Woman is the happiness of a man. Actually, he misquotes that. The exact meaning of that Latin phrase is that, woman is the reason for the downfall of the man. You got it? Woman is the reason for the downfall of the man. He believed in his wife, even though he believed in his own dreams. He was forced to believe what his wife says. Has he followed his wife's advice? If he has taken his wife's advice, and what happened? He was caught by a fox, isn't it? So this is a satire. Let me tell you, Nun's Priest Tale is a satire. It discusses about the issue of women's council. The particular priest says that no one should take one's wife's advice. If they take, that will become the reason for their downfall. It also discusses the theme of flattery and pride. Why? See, Chanticleer was caught by the fox just because he believed in the flattery of fox. The fox has flattered Chanticleer, telling that he hasn't seen such a beautiful rooster in that part of the area. So that made this Chanticleer very happy, and he became very haughty and started to sing, isn't it? So that is the story of Nun Priest. Anyway, let me tell you, please study. Please get the summary of Nun Priest, and please study Canterbury Tales in prologue to Canterbury Tales in detail. So that's all about the block one. We have completed block one. If you have any doubt, if you have any doubt regarding how to study Canterbury Tales, please feel free to ask me. We can meet next week.
Ma'am?
Yeah.
Ma'am, if you don't mind, could you please share your number in this group? Because in case if we have any doubt, we need to discuss about that.
Yes, yes. Of course. Let me tell you, you should also download question papers somewhat. Question papers. Last 5 years question papers. Okay. 5 years question papers.
Okay,
I will share my number. Please add me in the group. Also, please make me an admin. Then only I'll be able to share my notes. One second.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yeah. Please ask me.
Ma'am, actually, Sadhguru is the only student who is the admin. So I'll send your number to him and he will make you the admin in the group. Only the teachers are the admins in the group, including Prema teacher. And since Sadhguru created the group, he is the student admin. So we will inform the student. I don't know if he is in the call or not. I'll inform it to him.
Can you see my phone number over there? 920-740-3329. Can
yes,
you see
ma'am.
My phone number?
Yes,
okay,
ma'am.
Okay.
Ma'am,
if you want, I can forward some media.
One more doubt. Ma'am, when we write the answers, should we mention the annotations in a complete sentence, or just we can put dot and we can explain that thing?
No. My dear, your annotation is out of 10 marks, so make sure that you write at least 2 pages. Okay, two and a half pages. Three, strictly in 3 paragraphs.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Don't write in a clumsy manner. And apart, you should underline your points.
Okay.
It doesn't matter whether you write 5 pages, 10 pages, whatever. Okay. Points are of the most important.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Okay, let me ask you, I just want some feedback from you. I don't know how far you were able to understand Canterbury Tales. At least have you got an overview about Canterbury Tales?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much for giving such wonderful class. I've been waiting for 1 year for such a class, ma'am.
because we have some limitation for holding class online. That is why I'm asking you. I know we have some network issue, and many of you have messaged me that we can't hear you. Audio issues, ma'am. But I don't know.
For me, it was very clear, ma'am. And another thing I want to tell you is that I'm from a non-literature background. I have completed my political science, and this is the first time attending a proper class, actually. Okay. I really appreciate that. It was from the basic, and now I'm able to understand how to study. And it was really, really awesome to get the basics from you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Okay. So I will forward some notes of Canterbury Tales if you add me in the group. Okay.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, okay. Then meet you next week, same time, Sunday. Okay.
Sure, ma'am. Thank sure.
You, ma'am. Be ready.
Thank you, ma'am.
Be ready with block.
Thank.
Bye, bye.
Thank you, ma'am.
Bye, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Bye. Thank you, ma'am.